The very nature of this work sprint, there seems to be kind of this expectation to create something new or something revolutionary, something complex. But in this pursuit, there is things that are overlooked, just kind of in this cloud almost. We want to return to it and return to these intangible things that other people would not normally focus on. So instead of creating a project, we just kind of decided to focus on these intangible traits. And we did that through three ways. So the first of which is going to be the kind of balloon project. But the three projects as a whole, the first one was just kind of spread kindness as a whole. The second one was to kind of understand empathy as an idea. And the third one was to kind of give an opportunity for giving and kind of get into the mindset of giving as a whole in general.
I created a video, and basically the video that you're going to see is going to kind of have a little bit of everything that we did. Also, one of our experiments, actually somebody came up and took a balloon, popped the balloon, and you kind of will see that through the video. And it, at the end of the video, you'll see them kissing. It's kind of really cute. The kindness note, something kind of sparked up between them. And that's what you guys will see right now. As well as our box of dum-dums.
The marshmallows are also gone, and then I saw another homeless person with those marshmallows, so the opposite effect of what I was trying to do. The third one was kind of more so of compliments, almost. And so I did this sign, you give me hope and happiness with your existence. It's kind of creepy, but it worked out. It brightened a lot of people's day. Made a lot of eye contact with people. They were smiling at me. They got a lot more reaction. I got more money. I got like $4 from it instead of, you know, a stolen dollar. The second one was, I put, your smile is beautiful, please keep smiling. That's also kind of creepy, but that just worked phenomenally. People came over and they were happy, they were talking to me, and I got $5. I got this like drink thing that was kind of strange. I haven't given it away yet. We're gonna give it out after this. I just wanted to show that. I ended up giving that sign away so other people could use it. And what I found was that just kind of 90-95% of people just have a tendency to just tune out the homeless population in general, where they won't even look at these signs to get the intended effect that we're trying to measure. But then again, the homeless population's not always in a position to kind of spread the things that I was trying to do in the first place. So that was a sign that worked out real well. That's just my stuff.
Yeah. So, yeah, similar to Billy, I had like a sign that tried to evoke empathy, and I had a couple of other signs that were just kind of general statements, and one of them hit on humor, which is this one. For this one here, like 100% of the people just ignored it, walked past, like didn't pay any attention to me. The only money that I did get from it was from the security guard who told me to leave, and he felt bad, so he gave me $4. However, when I moved to a different location with a different sign, this one, I got a lot more attention. I was approached like 5 to 6 times, and I made more money than I did with the one I tried to evoke empathy. And even with these here, I made like $2 off of each sign. So I think the conclusions that we drew from these were that people, I guess, respond more to like humor or something that they can appreciate. If they're seeing, you know, someone on the street who's begging and, you know, trying to get people to empathize with how bad he has it, you know, it's kind of hard for someone who's also going through a hard time to pay attention to that. So yeah, it's easier for people to respond to something they can relate to or that they find appreciation.
Okay, and then, so we kind of wanted to create a progression. So it was first to sort of spread kindness, then to be on the other side of it, and then to create opportunities for it. So we, sort of coming from the homeless simulation, wanted to understand more of the why, as to why people would engage in kind activity, and understand if it was a convenience issue or if it was something more than that. So we created this sort of game-like situation. Went out with a box of Dum Dums and these sort of instructions and put it just out in the park. I wanted to emphasize the want versus need, because I think another part of this and another part of kindness that we discovered was just creating something to stop somebody in their tracks and just ponder something deeper, bigger. So there wasn't a whole lot of, I guess, data that came from it or greater understanding. The biggest thing that was significant was the social trust aspect. So the first person that approached this box in the park was the security guard. He spent about 10 to 15 minutes on his walkie-talkie, basically trying to establish that this was not a threat. And so I think that was sort of the heaviest part of it, was like, that's the world that we live in. We're putting a box of lollipops out in a park. You have to sort of assume that there's deception and kindness. And then through all of this, I sort of dubbed it the 24-hour effect. There was, we were trying to sort of get data on the choice. So are you going to share it? Or are you going to keep it for yourself? Obviously, there was no way for me to measure that, to track that. And that sort of became, I guess, the overarching theme of the project. For us, we actually started with an idea to create a campaign to actually create. We had a website, we had an idea for a technology that would create sort of a forum of kindness where you can track
you know, a letter that you picked up, we would have a QR code, and we would sort of follow the progression of kindness throughout the city. Obviously, the technology kind of failed us, and we were sitting here yesterday morning with the question of, you know, what do we do when all of this, you know, has not worked out. The Phoenix campaign was sort of the marker of the rebirth of kindness. But I think we sort of established that even without sort of the backing of this larger campaign and this larger technology, that we still had balloons and notes and a purpose of just going out and being kind, and that was sort of all we needed.
You'll see our posters out on the street. I'm sure you guys have probably seen a couple of them. If you see the symbol, that's our poster.
Not that it matters though, because we're
good. Yeah. Would you guys, any volunteers that want to pop one of our balloons?
Oh my gosh.
That's kind of
nice. I knew it. Do you want me to read it out loud?
It's up to you.
Have you wish? The most precious resource we have is time. Donate the gift of time by volunteering at our local NGO that means something to you. Phoenix campaign.
Yeah.
That's good.
I feel this.
Can you share a little bit more about the experience of being homeless for 6 hours?
It's really boring because you just sit there and you hope something that happens. Otherwise, you're just sitting there and asleep.
The first half for me went really well. That's when I had more positive signs. And then as I transitioned to the end, more homeless people kind of gathered around me. And one of them was just kind of like shooting heroin like right next to me. And so I didn't get much after that. So.
When people came to talk to you, what kind of stuff did they ask you or converse about?
There was this one lady who just kind of dropped off a message. She was just says, like, wherever you are, find someone who knows the secrets of this place and ask him or her to show you something beautiful. And that's it. She just left after that. So it was, no one really tried to converse with us, at least on my side. I'm not sure if you got anything from Chipotle or anything like that.
The only interaction I had with people by coming up and just getting money and walking away. So, I mean, the only way we can tell how our signs impacted them or if, like, there weren't any interaction was how many people approached us, like, how much money we made off of us. Yes.
I know when I was in India, like, my stance on poverty kind of changed a little bit. Did you guys experience the same thing when you were with India and stuff?
I mean, I definitely had that with deeper. People who are homeless or on the streets, but I think at least in San Francisco, the main problem, or the main reason for that is drugs, like just abuse for it and not really any self-control or priority in how they manage their life. Mm-hmm. So I feel bad, but like that's kind of it.
Anything surprise you about either the homeless people you saw around you or the people who are walking by. Just something I've seen is that in India, it was mostly women and children, and I've seen a lot of men here. Anything that you noticed that was like maybe different from India, different from what you've seen before when you've encountered homeless people that weren't in San Francisco?
Well, obviously it is predominantly a male homeless population. Exactly why that is in India is kind of relates to a larger socioeconomic and cultural thing. I don't want to make any kind of assumptions about, you know, why that is. It's just something more to kind of look into to see how that cultural global aspect is kind of affects that.
Last question. So I was just going to ask, when you did do the not homeless, but just need Chipotle, like, did you get like more like conversations from people or like laughter, or because I know that like from things I've seen in the past, there's been like people get more money from like saying on their poster like homeless just need money for like drugs or need money for weed. I don't think that would work here because everyone is so involved in the drug world that's homeless, but it's worked in other places. But I think, like, did people react more with you when you did humor?
Yeah, there actually was, like, even though I didn't really get any conversations, there were a lot of people who would walk by, like, stare at the sign and smile, like, as a passing, or some people just do a double take. And I definitely think there's something in, like, bluntness or humor in, like, how you beg, I guess. Because, like, on the way here, I passed by another homeless person who decided to spread some cheese on this bro cracker. I was, like, that alone just made me want to give him some money, but I didn't have anything on me at the time. So, I don't know. There's just something about that that makes people appreciate it, like, right in their day.
I think those were the most, like, fascinating results because, like, I think we've all sort of seen those homeless people with the more entertaining signs, and sure, that maybe is more successful, but they're going to specifically state it and very clearly not homeless. So, like, the fact that people are more willing to give, maybe it's because they know where their money's going to, like, it's clearly stated, but there was so much sort of psychology in that alone.
What did you guys wear?
I wore this big green jacket, a hat, tennis shoes, and sweatpants.
Yeah, I just kind of wore this kind of baggy sweatshirt that I had with a hat and a hood on, just kind of black sweatpants, just kind of curled up in a little ball. Emily and Brian and Ella, I think it was, walked by me. They didn't notice me at first, and they like just kind of freaked out when they saw me and realized it was me.